I got them keys, keys, keys. 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 We go to court and complete the field. I know the judge, I'ma shoot him some chips. I got them keys, keys, keys. I got them keys, keys, keys. Welcome back to another episode of the Weedham Brothers Podcast, episode number 26. I'm Jimmy Hicks. You always get mad when I introduce you, so
there's no need. I'm self-introduction. You know who I am.
This is Anthony Rogerson.
I'm Anthony Rogerson. That is Jimmy Hicks.
We have a very special guest in the house today.
We got gumbo in the house.
Yes.
We got some gumbo in the house today. We got some gumbo in the house today. We've been having some bland introductions.
We're not going to do that to our previous guests who were so patient and cool with us and gracious to come up here. We're not going to shade.
Yeah, no.
Our previous guest.
There's no shade to the previous guest. All I'm saying is we got some Creole gumbo ain'ts in the house.
Ooh, not the ain't.
We have, get introduced.
Hey, Andy Dalton threw 6 touchdown passes last night. All right. Now, 2 of them was to the other team.
Mm.
But we're not going to talk about that. So, got a special guest in the house.
Without any further ado, we have Miss Dashondra Mashia.
You're going to have to redo it because that's not how you pronounce my name.
Dashondra Mashia.
You left the R out of Dashondra. You said Dashondra.
Dashondra.
We got Dash in here.
Yeah. Get to the point, right? Dash.
She's trying to get cute all the multi-syllables. I don't do that well. But we have Miss Dashondra Mashia.
Yes. Absolutely. Thank you for coming.
How you feeling?
I feel great. It's a good day. It's Friday.
All right. You look great.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you.
We told her to bring her luggage on camera, but she put it in the back. It's very expensive stuff. We got expensive guests on today. Expensive taste. Most expensivest shit out there.
To let you know that she out here winning deals.
She out here winning the clothesline.
So
her bag says she came on her Instagram bag today, y'all. She got a real life Instagram bag. She walked through the building with it today, and she says, "I close deals, bitches."
The bag definitely said that.
That might be a phrase.
The bag says that.
Yeah. So thank you for coming.
Yes.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us. Well, let's say this. We have a multi-million-dollar producer,
yes,
Ms. Mashia, sitting here. Right? Don't talk your talk. This ain't I close one deal this year. Multi-million. It's like Grammy Award winning.
Yes.
When you win a Grammy, even when you
gotta address
up for a Grammy, they always say Grammy Award winning or Grammy nominated.
For the rest of his life.
From here on out, you can say multi-million dollar producer.
Okay.
Talk that shit.
Okay.
Yeah. How's it going?
Business is great. Life is great. It's been a transition in the market for sure over the past 4 or 5 months, but mm-hmm. everything's still going good.
Nice.
Talk about coming off of a really good, based on the data suggests.
Right.
Based on the data, right? Because this is just not opinion. Based on the data, you had a great 2021, mm-hmm. relatively speaking. Mm-hmm. We know in sales, everything can always be better. Talk about that transition that has happened in the market and how you have been able to sustain, or the challenge of the sustainability with all of that has happened in the market. Talk a little bit about that, if you will.
Yeah, so one, going into 2021 was a transition in and of itself. The hyper accelerated market where there's 30, 40, 50 offers per house. Yeah. I primarily work with buyers. So when you have a situation like that where every buyer is competing against, seems like the entire city,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's a
literally.
That's a transition in and of itself. And so now we're transitioning out of that. So it's been a lot happening in a relatively short amount of time. The way that I have sustained is really just staying educated, staying out in the market, you know, knowing what is going on and what's best for my clients.
Gotcha.
And also transitioning kind of like my marketing focus. Before the transition of this year, I was more so focused on educating people on how to win.
Mm.
Because that was the market. It was competition.
Mm-hmm.
And so now I can kind of take a step back and get back to what I love, which is more so educating buyers on the process, educating them on how to make a good investment.
Mm-hmm.
Because for the past, I would say, 18 months prior to June of this year, it was, I'm just going to make the best investment I can. I'm just trying to get in the game. That was like what it was for most people.
Right, right. And in educating, you talk about what you love to do in terms of educating people to get in the market. What we've seen from our seats is a segment of the market, because we, I think we would say we enjoy educating.
Oh yeah, I think that's one of the our most favorite things to do. That's reason for this platform.
Not favorite.
I'll speak for myself. Like I love that. My favorite part is educating the people on the process, and because that's the reason that we started up this podcast is because not a lot of people, especially our people, know the ins and outs of the real estate market, right. And this is one of the, if not the biggest ways to generate wealth and generational wealth on top of that.
Right.
So I will say, yes, I speak it for myself. I do love the education piece of it.
Yeah.
I like the education piece of it. I love smoking weed. No, I don't smoke weed. Let me stop lying. I don't want to offend any of the weed smokers. I don't smoke weed, y'all, but that's okay. But no, so, but. I don't know, man.
I plead the fifth.
You do that.
I'm speaking for you. Right? You're speaking for yourself, right? No. So we've seen somewhat of that segment of, there was a time where we could educate people and there was a huge segment of the market that still needs the education to this day. But with this market shift, it has left a lot of people behind, mm-hmm. right? Have you experienced the challenge of someone that you was educating before and you felt confident in that, yes, I can educate you and we can get you to the closing table, but now I can educate you, but I can't necessarily get you to the closing table because what the market has done? Have you experienced that, or has your clientele kept up with the business? And the $200,000 house that is now a $400,000 house, has your clientele kept up with that? And if so, how have you been able to do that?
No, I've definitely had people get priced out.
Right.
And not for lack of anything but their own apprehension, not for lack of not being ready, not for lack of not having the funds. It was just, you know, it's kind of a personality thing to be able to and want to be aggressive and right. compete in an aggressive market.
Right.
And some people are just like, this is not for me right now. I'll wait. I'll whatever I got to do, I'm not doing this.
Right.
And now 6 months later, literally the same house is $100,000 higher, right. you know? So
right.
while you were already struggling to find things, you know, if your budget isn't, you know, some substantial amount of money, if you in Atlanta, if you have a budget less than $300,000, your choices are very limited.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Not even speaking to the competition that was also limiting what people had available to choose from. But anyway, budget-wise, you're already restricted. You're not seeing everybody wants something a little bit nicer than what their budget can afford.
Right.
So you're already like, oh, you know, well, I wish it didn't have carpet. Oh, I want the paint to be this, you know, cosmetic things. Oh, I wish the hardware looked like this, or there was a bedroom in this space instead of that space. You're dealing with that, and now it's like, now that even costs $100,000 more than it did, you know, just a few months ago. So people have definitely gotten priced out, unfortunately. They say the best time to buy real estate was yesterday, always.
Right.
There's always going to be pros and cons to the market. You just have to be educated and know, you know, this is what I'm dealing with now, and this is how I will combat that in the future.
Right. So to those points, there was a time where you could be quote unquote selective in, I'm waiting for the house that I love,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Coming out of when we came through COVID and that mad dash to buy something,
mm-hmm.
you had to submit blind offers.
Yeah.
Right? Never mind if you love it. Never
yeah.
mind. Love,
yeah.
Do you think
this house is on the market.
This house is on the market.
You're right.
It's for
do
sale.
You think that you can live on the street?
Right, right.
Do you think right. that you can live on the street? Right? Never mind.
You live within an hour of your job.
Yes, right. exactly. I know you asked for 5 bedrooms and this is a studio, but
But it's for sale.
We can get five partitions right. and make it work. Right?
Right.
So that's how crazy things work. Yeah, right? We're yeah. going to partition this thing off. Trust right. me, it has great views. Whatever. Right?
Parking lot.
Right.
Right.
Basement window. But so we went through that. So coming out of that, prices are a bit higher, mm-hmm. right? Average home price is about $400,000 if we're just using that right now. Yeah. And in that price point, what has changed somewhat is people will buy a house for $200,000 for the stuff that they say they had a checklist of 10 items. And if it had six things on their checklist, they're like, yeah, okay, that's cool. Yeah. I can add these knobs. Mm-hmm. I can right. redo these carpets. Talk a little bit to what you're seeing about people who are stretching their budget to the $400,000 price point, and they may not have that extra money to do the other things, right? So mm-hmm. Are you seeing that they want everything in that 400? What are you seeing from that? Am I making the question
yeah,
clear?
That makes sense. It really just depends, excuse me, on the buyer. Mm-hmm. I have some people who, you know, they may not have money to do the upgrades or the renovations right now, but they're willing to wait until they can save that money up. And, you know, in a year or two, then they're making it the house that they really want.
Right.
There are other people who they like, if it don't have everything I want, then I'm not buying it. But that's a different mindset. And I try to really teach people, like, that is not, if the goal is ultimately, especially for first time home buyers, your first home is not your forever home. It is an investment to make you right. some money to get to the next house.
Right.
And
right.
the next house might be your forever home, but more than likely it's not either.
Right.
So the goal is really to make money. Of course, you want to be comfortable where you are. You want to feel safe. You want to, you know, have things within reason that make sense to your life right now. But I really try to get people to think big.
Think right. big, bitch. Right. Think big, bitch. Right. You're on a
I want you to see the big picture and see, you know, what really is most important. Like, is carpet the most important thing to you right now?
Right.
Or is it a house that, because of this neighborhood, we know it's accelerating 10% faster than the Atlanta market, so you're going to have 30% equity in 1 year. You know,
right.
like,
right.
those are the things that really matter. For first-time home buyers
right.
specifically.
Right, and with those first-time buyers and in the education part of it, what are you telling buyers who right now rates, and people are going to say rates are at their all-time high, but they're really not.
No.
Right?
No.
Like if we do the math over the last 20 years, rates were like 5%? Is that where rates?
I think the average rate.
He's a smart guy. I just pulled shit out of the sky. OHBCU. Come on, homecoming. Bring it on in, baby.
If I'm not mistaken, the average rate over the past 10 years has been like 3.8.
That's right.
And over the past 20 years, it goes up to 4 and some change, I believe.
Okay.
But there have been several fluctuations right. in between that. So we've seen rates, we probably haven't seen it since we've been in the business, but there have been rates like right before we got in the business where they were 8, 9, 10%.
Right.
Like, I know your grandma probably bought her house for $50,000 back in the day, but ask her how much her interest rate
right.
was.
Right.
So that those fluctuations also dictate that once we get through this whole inflation, recession, whatever the economy is doing, that rates are also going to come back down eventually.
Right.
And we always tell, like, everything is up right now. Rates are up. Housing values are up. Housing prices are up. Only one of those are going to come down.
Right.
And that's interest rates.
So if we're saying everything is up, right? Someone comes to you, Dashondra.
Get it right.
Sean, you got to introduce me again. It's my shit. I'm sorry. I'm on budget.
I know.
I do, right?
That's the New Yorker. That's the New Yorker.
I got it off my chest now. Okay. I'm on budget. Anyway, I digress. What do you say to your buyers who say, you know, everything is expensive right now, I think we're just going to wait, right? Like, how are you, without sounding like a saleswoman,
mm-hmm.
right? And not sounding like, I need you to buy a house so I can get this nice bag. I got bags I gotta keep up on. Crazy?
You ain't
seen it. You didn't see
the bag. Don't lie.
You didn't right. see the bag. I ain't gonna lie. You must ain't seen the podcast. See these bags I got? Bitch, you better buy this house. Right. Talk about weight. What are you talking about? No. How do you without sounding and none of us like I don't Jimmy doesn't want to do it. I don't want to twist your arm to right. get, to get a home loan, right?
Right.
I'm sure you don't want to twist someone's arm to purchase a house.
Right.
How do you straddle that line of being informative as the professional? Mm-hmm. Right? This is what you do, this is what you know, and you're like, Miss Brown, I hear you like wanting to wait. How do you straddle that and give them the information without coming across as salesy?
Yeah, so the first thing you said is you never want twisting one's arm, and I'm a firm believer in that because I'm not gonna work harder than you for this. This right. is this is your life, this is right. your investment, this is your equity.
Right.
So if you don't truly buy in and believe and want to do this, it's not gonna work.
Right.
So that's the first thing. The second thing is one, I try to inform people through my social media. That's like my primary way of getting information out. But if it's someone I'm talking to specifically, maybe we're in a buyer's consultation or something, and they're, you know, saying everything is up, then I'm just gonna tell them, you know, yeah, the prices are up, yeah, the values are up, but like you said, those things are not coming back down. You mm-hmm. have options. This is actually, in my opinion, a better time to buy than it was in 2021 or the first half of this year, because you have the opportunity to get seller concessions. The oh my god, the competition is so much lower when you talk about offers per home. And then also you have things like a 2-1 buy down where you can address the issues that make people apprehensive right now to buy. It was something else I was gonna say.
No. All those points. This is where I come clean up for you. I'm trained in media cleanup. If we edit that part or not. But no, all of those points are extremely, extremely valid in terms of you were like utilizing essentially. Excuse me. I don't want to get there yet. There's less competition right now,
mm-hmm.
right? And right now you are going to get the most incentives,
mm-hmm.
right? Talk to, and
remember my point.
Yeah, go ahead and say it.
My other point was that in 2021 and first half of this year, people were having to come out of pocket big time with paying appraisal gaps. And
it was a part of your negotiation.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. If you did not have a substantial amount of money in the bank, I'm talking beyond your 3% or 3.5% down and your 2-3% in closing costs, like you needed to have at least an extra $10,000 sitting right. around available to put towards your purchase.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That was also affecting people in regards to their equity. It's like, all right, I'm gonna put an extra $10,000 in, but it's only appraising, you know, for $10,000 less than what I'm paying. It's like, okay, but the market is accelerating. You know, right. you'll make that back. That was the conversation then. Right. Now people walking in with $50,000 of equity. So there are pros and cons to right. every market, to every day of the market. You just have to figure out, all right, these are the cons for right now. How can I address these? How can I overcome or alleviate these?
Right. So those are some. But there were people who I asked you this question, and I don't want to put the company on blast, but we had these cash program companies that were out there at the time
right.
that we were marketing, right? And what was it, cash? What is it, cash?
We pretty much were able to present your offer the same as cash.
Same as cash.
So like we had a backup cash buyer for you, so right. you can negotiate. Like that's when everybody was. Like cash was king, and then
needed
you might get a conventional, and then
days,
like right. if you had a government loan, forget about it.
Right.
Yeah.
But with these companies, should I say the name? Well, we shouldn't give them no.
I ain't giving them. No.
I know. Yeah, we're not.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. So we worked with these companies that pretty much served as like a backstop. So you could still present your offer same as the investors were, like as far as cash is concerned. We could still do your loan as long as we close before a certain date.
Right.
The seller was given some, not concessions. I guess the seller was given some relief.
Comfort.
To where they knew, okay, if the financing company can't get it done by this date, we have the other company that's going to present a cash offer like right from there.
Right.
So they know that they were going to close with somebody regardless right. by this date.
Right. Right.
And I don't want to step on your point, but I don't think that is really in play now.
No, that was Dashondra's point in that those appraisal gaps, right?
Right.
So a lot of times those companies, case in point for those, they paid up a lot,
mm-hmm. right?
They covered that appraisal gap, mm-hmm. right? So depending on when that was done, because the market, it hasn't accelerated like it was 12 months ago. It's right. kind of plateaued, right?
Right.
But now if the buyer or those companies, whoever paid that gap, that extra $20,000, in a lot of instances, depending on when you close, that $20,000 hasn't been covered yet.
Exactly.
Right. It didn't. The home didn't appreciate to that $20,000.
Right.
So you got. And I didn't think about this until. And in walks great idea. Holy shit, boy! When that ball goes off, right. this thing, up in this ball piece up here.
Real smart,
what?
Right?
What? I could take the SAT right now. Hey, they make me do a redo. Can I take the SAT right now? Fucked up back then. I wasn't that bright. But what I was thinking about in that is if those appraisal gaps were paid when the market kind of halted and got steady,
mm-hmm.
a lot of people are somewhat underwater.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Maybe not by much, but they're underwater with that $10,000 and having to pay the commissions
mm-hmm.
if they chose to sell.
Right.
Some folks will have to come out of pocket to that. Yeah. So that's what I thought about when you said that. But to your point of this is a great time to buy, and this so we try not to be gloom and doom, right?
Right.
We know the cons, the pros more than anything right now. And if someone was to ask me or ask us right now, why should I buy right now? And we talk about this all the time. Right now, Dashondra, she can go out there and get you more money than you've been able to get someone in 2 years.
Yeah.
2 years. Sure. Like, yes, the house is a little bit more expensive, but that doesn't matter because that payment is 360 months, which right. is 30 years. Okay. But if Dashondra can get you the most money right now, and you have to come out of your pocket with less, that matters.
Absolutely.
And that is impactful. So for all of those who have watched our platform, who continue to watch our platform, who think that I'm gonna wait, right? We're a huge advocate of do not wait.
No.
Do not wait. And we're not well, I'm trying to get you to buy a house.
I mean, we got kids to feed, too.
We got kids to feed.
we got bags to buy. Right.
To buy. And bags don't. Right. We got bags to buy, bitch, and bags don't lie. I'm going to copyright that. Shit. I can see somebody using that as a
all
voice.
All my clients now are going to be like, what bag you got?
Right.
What bag?
Right now, until you buy this house, I got a public bag.
Right.
Until we close, I'm right. walking. Every time you see me, I got this right. public plastic bag. I can't walk in here looking cute. You might think I don't need this.
Exactly.
I need this goddamn clothing. But yeah, so it's again, we can't stress it enough. And as we go into, today is October 21st. We're going into the holiday season.
Mm-hmm.
And to your point about the competition getting less
mm-hmm.
as we go into the holiday season.
Yeah, this is the low season.
Talk a little bit about why it is the low season, if you will.
Yeah, please. Most people just don't want to move around Thanksgiving and Christmas right. and New Year's. They right. want to be with their family. They want to travel. They want to be settled. So most people just aren't looking to buy a house at this, you know, in this season.
Right.
But it's a great time for people who do have that flexibility
right.
to mm-hmm. move during Christmas.
Right.
You know, competition is even lower. And a seller who is looking to sell right now, oh, baby, they want to sell.
Right.
Right.
Because who wants to uproot their life during
right.
the holidays?
Right.
So if they're looking to sell right now, they definitely have, you know, motive to get it done.
Right. Right. So that makes the pot even sweeter.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yep.
Talk a little bit about as the realtor, just wrapping up the fourth quarter of your business, right? Because what happens, this is what we see from our seat, you mm-hmm. know, a lot of, and I think sometimes loan officers, I don't necessarily do it because I still got bills and,
right.
you know, and a teenager to feed.
We ain't got no off season.
Yeah, people in sales, and I won't say the successful people because I don't think we do it, take their foot off the gas going into the holiday season, right? Right. It's easy for someone to pack it up and say, there's no business out there. This is the holidays and I'm just going to pick it back up January 1, right? Yeah. Talk a little bit about how you're finishing strong and, in your opinion, why it's important to finish strong.
Yeah, I don't believe, I guess I'm like you guys, I don't believe in taking my foot off the gas.
Right.
In any season. With real estate, you have to continually feed your pipeline. You have to continually get people, get those consultations going, because everybody's not going to be ready immediately. A lot of times when I speak with people, they need 6 months. They need a year before, you know, everything is in line for them to truly be, you know, a prepared buyer. So if I take my foot off the brake, that look like me sitting around twiddling my thumbs for 6 months take my foot off the gas because I don't have anybody in my pipeline.
Right.
So
right.
for me.
And that's scary.
Yeah.
Are we talking to him?
You pick it up January 1, you might not end up closing till March.
Oh, you're not.
Exactly. Right,
so
exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Say that, hold on. Say that again. So the,
you pick it up January 1. Because like you said, to your point, like a lot of people are looking down the line. They're not mm-hmm. looking to buy within the next 30 days. Mm-hmm. So if you just pick that up with them January 1st, you might not have a close until March, maybe even April.
Yeah.
Depending on who you're talking to and how
April's
soon they're ready.
April's the fourth month of the year. I'm not that smart. I ain't doing SAT. But if you ain't getting a check until the fourth month of the year.
It's a problem. Yeah. It's definitely a problem.
How you out here being a top producer, right. not unless that's a real big check now, you know.
But I mean, if you're going straight into like.
$4 million.
Right.
You know what I mean? But.
That luxury word we like to. That luxury. We like to throw around.
We were bashing luxury.
I don't want to say we were bashing.
But I was bashing.
We were bashing the people that use it as a crutch. They just put it in front of their name without doing the work.
And not having the bag.
Right.
The
like everybody. Right. Right.
And I don't even brand myself as a luxury realtor.
I didn't show you. She's guilty. It wasn't me. Don't do no shit with
But no, I think I think if we go on Instagram right now, I would say the vast majority of the agents that are on Instagram have luxury somewhere in there.
Yeah.
Everybody can't be selling. Like luxury is like $1 million like mansions, like stuff like that. Like you're
luxury
only dealing with like
subjective. There is no true definition of luxury.
Shit. I hear you, Ms. Optimistic. But no. Go ahead, I cut you off. I'm sorry, you're going being like Nori right now.
Right.
Go ahead. Finish your subjective to luxury, because my hunger ain't fucking subjective. I know hot dogs and beans versus filet mignon.
Hey, I tell you all the time, Five Guys got the best burger in Douglasville. I wouldn't consider them luxury though.
I want to hear luxury is subjective. Please expound.
So it is what that person perceives as luxury. So, okay, in a true sense, when I need to give a real definition in regards to real estate, I'll tell people $700,000 and up if we're talking numbers on houses. The average price point in Atlanta, the highest we've hit was around $520,000, and that was a few months ago. So really anything over that could also be considered as luxury. Some people believe in providing a luxury experience regardless of the price point. So branding yourself, I'm not knocking any agent who brands themselves as luxury, even if they if they aren't doing primarily or exclusively high dollar sales, you know, there's a way to be true to the word.
No,
that's definitely a different way to look at it. Because if you're providing a luxury experience, that's different. Like if I'm just buying a $200,000 condo,
meet me at the showing on Marta.
But if
meet me at Senior Center,
but if you get off the Marta and they got like a nice Ace of Spades bottle for you for the closing, then like that's luxury a little bit, right?
It is not. Follow it.
Like, good luck getting that Ace of Spades bottle on the Marta back.
Luxury. I'm lying. Lead you right tomorrow. What are you saying?
So
we get it. So in context, to keep it in context, go look at episode 25. We ain't got to repeat ourselves. How about that? Y'all know what we're talking about. No. In context, we were really just talking about the image that is we know this, and this is a bigger conversation outside of real estate. Just the image that is portrayed on social media. Mm-hmm. Like, right. Everything is luxury, right? Mm-hmm. Like, present your business however you present your business, right? And like, and know that, and it goes across the board. Like, I'm very jovial and I fuck around a lot. That's gonna turn some people off, right? Like, he might not be serious.
Yeah, everybody's not everybody's cup of tea.
I've probably lost business and just being me, but it's easier for me to be me and just have, what they say, meet your tribe.
Yeah.
My tribe comes to me and I'm fine with that. But if you, what we're talking about, the luxury space, there's a whole demographic that potentially wants to buy a house, and they look at that and they be like, she's above us. She's only talking to luxury people. I'm trying to get something right here off of so-and-so. Yeah. You know,
this $200,000 house on Riverdale.
Right. Like, She's too busy to show me this $200,000 house in Riverdale.
Right.
And you're like, no, I'm not. Right. I can show it. So I think that if you're, and this is hard in the social media space, transparency is hard in the social media space, right? Right. But if you're being transparent, it's like, listen, I don't, I'll take a $200,000 loan, I'll take a $2 million loan, and I can do both equally as well, right? Mm-hmm. So that's really what we're talking about in the sense of luxury. How are you, we talked a little bit about, well, we mentioned pipeline, mm-hmm. keeping the pipeline full. Mm-hmm. We all need to keep our pipeline full. Without giving away your secret sauce, how
I
is
am
it,
the secret sauce.
Heard that.
Bags don't lie.
Did you
see the shimmy? Did you see the shimmy? She didn't even put them on mute. What the fuck are you looking at? What
the
fuck are you talking about?
You looking at
the
song.
Right.
No, but seriously, I think in this day and age, a lot of realtors lean on social media for marketing, for farming. And I am one of those realtors also. I mean, I do other things outside of social media. I do, like, do some mail outs and stuff like that. I send out some magnets to my neighborhood with the Falcons schedule on them at the start of football season. So stuff like that.
We can pull up the standards right now.
So I do a little bit of local marketing. But for the most part, my marketing is social media. But like you said, you didn't say this, but it was something I was thinking when you were saying about.
I'm that fucking good. I don't even gotta say some shit. Like you said, I'm like, if it's some good shit, what she said, I'm like, say that shit.
I said that.
If that shit is right, I'm like, I didn't say that shit. Dude, I didn't. That wasn't me. That was.
Nah, I was thinking
your
about.
Podcast is confused.
I was thinking about how you could see two luxury agents on Instagram, and one of them you feel like is relatable. I can work with them with my $200,000 budget.
Right.
The other one, I don't feel like would even blink at me.
Right.
You know. And I think that is what I mean when I say that's the sauce.
Right.
Like, it's the person. It's their personality.
That is true.
It is. Are they approachable? Are they personable? Do they? I get only marketing and showing the nicer looking properties or the higher value properties because that is part of the brand and you want to make sure you can attract and secure those people.
Right.
But there is also a fine line in making sure that everybody understands that they can work with you.
Right.
So
let me ask you this, and it ties into the marketing, right? And I'm married to a realtor, right? His name is Brad. I'm so wrong. My wife's name is April. No disrespect.
Hey, but if we're going for a different demographic, then
hey. Listen. Hey, for a loan or two.
Anything for a loan.
$40 is $40. Huh?
Judge your mother. I'm was only joking. Brad, you good in my book, bro.
You all good in the hood.
All good in my book. But what April and I were talking about is I'll get on social media and just hit record.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I had a very early on in social media, I had a challenging time because I'm not really that showy. Like, I don't like really showing shit. And then I was also finding my voice on social media, mm-hmm. right? And I had to realize, in real life, I've never struggled to find my voice. Like, I'm that dude.
Yeah.
I'm that dude in
real
life. Yeah. So, I'm not that dude. Maybe it's in my head, but I'm that dude.
Right. As long as you believe it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When I've said, I'm that dude, y'all was supposed to say, yeah! I didn't like y'all response. I was like, this nigga's crazy.
Yeah. Like,
Right. Where's he going with this?
Where is he going with this? But no. So I was struggling really to just find my social media voice until I said to myself, I'm gonna just fucking be who I am, mm-hmm. right? From a woman's position, right? And this is the conversation that April and I was having. I'm like, yo, go on and film some shit. Like you have wonderful ideas. She's mm-hmm. like really intelligent. She's a great agent.
She looks smart.
I'm that dude. But no, she's smart. She's very smart. But what she was saying is, Jimmy and I have the luxury as men to just jump on social media, hit play, and record, irrespective of how we're looking that day, blah, blah, blah. I might not have shaved, whatever the case may be.
I would agree.
From your seat, because you dolled up today, we see you. See the shimmy? The shimmy is a thing. How do you balance that you want to get something out there mm-hmm. on your page, but you might not necessarily feel like
I look like that girl that day. Yeah.
Right. So how do you balance that, or do you balance that? Because I think that's a real thing. And is that a real thing for you?
It is a real thing. I definitely want to look put together when I'm on the internet.
Right.
Videos live forever. Right. I never know who I'm reaching. I've had some TikTok videos get 100 plays. I've had TikTok videos get 50,000 plays.
Right.
So, you know, I think I always keep that front of mind whenever I'm going to be in a public space or mm-hmm. a video space. It is a hard thing to balance as a woman. I have a content calendar that I don't stick to.
Mm-hmm. what prohibits you from sticking to it? You might not be in the
just
mood that
life.
Day.
You know, yeah. I be busy. You know, when you're a full-time realtor, you can plan your day, but that may not be how your day, you know, ends right. up going. Some things take longer than you anticipate, you know, things like that. Unexpected meetings pop up, and some of the meetings you're like, oh, this is happening today, I'm making time for it, whatever
right.
whatever I gotta move around. So I mean, one thing I do to kind of work within that is when I know I'm gonna film content, like in my office, I will do my makeup, do my hair, put on one shirt and earring, because I probably got on pajama pants up
right.
under there
right.
but put on one shirt and earring and one lip color, film a video, go change my lip color, change my shirt, film another video. So it looked different, right. but it's really me just sitting. And sometimes I don't even go to that extent. If you go to my reels on my Instagram, you'll see several videos with the same exact outfit.
Right.
I just film them back to back.
But you got the vibe. You got the vibe.
Yeah, yeah. I film them back to back. And it's not crazy, because it just shows, like, it gives your aesthetic of your Instagram a little bit of consistency when you're looking at the profile of it. But
right.
Yeah, I just do the best I can, because really, if you do nothing, then you're doing nothing. So
right.
I try to do something to do something.
Right. I got you. I got you. No, I think that's a real thing. So for all of you realtors out there, we're not making this sexist. What we're talking about, men and women, the difference of just being able, we do have the luxury. Some of us men, right? Some of us men are glam men, and we want to make sure we have a pedicure and manicure and all that before we shoot our face. But that ain't necessarily me. But I think what's most important is getting the message out there,
yeah.
right?
But yeah.
specifically, if we're talking about, like, as Jimmy said a while ago, we developed this platform to educate,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And if that's what your goal is, and well, to educate and make money.
Yeah,
I ain't doing this for free.
Yeah, right? I love the people, and I want to give you all the information, but there's a motive behind it.
So, but just... I guess stay consistent, right? Mm-hmm. Stay consistent mm-hmm. with your message. And your message could be like, it's going to be like water. It's going to be fluid in the right. sense of, well, not your message, not inconsistency of your message, but what we're talking about specifically will change, but your message overall will stay the same, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
Talking about our message and something that you said a couple minutes ago, we talked about buy downs, right? Mm-hmm. Buy downs, I hate the phrase, it's the hot thing right now. Right, but it's the thing of right now,
mm-hmm. yeah.
right? Talk a little bit, Jimmy, and we talked about this before. And Dashondra, please add on. We just went through a buy down like tutorial before we got on camera,
right.
so I don't want to put her on the spot.
No, but I'm good. I'm ready.
Okay, so we'll let you take the floor. Why in talking to a buyer during your consultation, why in your opinion does a buy down make sense in today's market?
Because one of the biggest pain points for buyers and one thing that everybody is going to mention is interest rates. So buy downs address the higher interest rates right now. Everybody wish they would have been able to have this level of competition with last year's interest rates. Well, you can get closer to that with a buy down. You can meet in the middle somewhere. You ain't gonna get quite to 2 or 3%, right, but you can get a lot closer than a 7.5 right, or a 7.25 with a buy down. So you have to get sellers concessions to do that. And then the first year of your mortgage, your interest rate will be 2% lower. The second year, it will be 1% lower. The third year, it'll go to what the current rate should have been from the start. But all the economists and experts believe that interest rates will drop in the next 2 years or so. So the idea is that you can refinance before it gets there. And if not, if they keep going up, then you still got a better interest rate for 2 years than you would have had otherwise.
Right, that was perfect. That was perfect.
Shimmy on the post. Right. Sorry. Perfectly stated. Like, you could not have stated it right, any better. And I won't even try because I'm gonna mess it up. I just felt like a proud. I had some. We did this right before. She came in smart, but I did the X's and O's. I X's and O's that shit. So yes. Jimmy, any points from you on today, like? The market in general, what should we be doing right now?
Well, I mean, just like you said, we tell people all the time, and we're having these same conversations just like we did when we first started the podcast. Like, we were telling people, buy now, because y'all are waiting. Y'all listen to everybody on Facebook. You listen to everybody in your family. Listen to everybody but the experts. And you're thinking that this crash is going to come and houses are going to fall back to $150,000. It's not happening.
Right.
So the same thing we've been telling people, like, if you don't buy now, we're going to be having the same conversation next year, just at a higher price point. And right now, we have a lot of people that didn't listen to us last year coming back this year.
Right.
We're having that same conversation at a higher price point.
Yeah.
So speaking of the buy downs, that is a great way to kind of alleviate the stress of having that higher monthly payment at the beginning of the loan and pretty much waiting this inflation, recession, whatever we're going throughout for rates to come back down.
Right.
So if you get into a buy down program, I think that's the best thing for everyone right now, especially if you're apprehensive about going into the market right now or buying a home right now because of interest rates. A lot of people like to try to buy down their interest rates permanently. I think it's, depending on your credit score, it's very expensive to do that right now. So I wouldn't advise it. I think the buy down would be a better situation because, let's say if you are at a 7.25 right now and you want to buy your rate down to 6.5 and it costs 4 points. Okay, great. Now hold you got on, a 6.5
on,
rate.
Hold on, because okay, we're getting in the weeds.
You're right.
We're getting
right
in the weeds. And I want you to slow it down. When you say it's costing 4 points,
that's 4%. Yeah, 4% of the loan amount. So okay, for easy math, if you got a $100,000 loan, that will cost you $4,000.
So multiply that out.
Multiply that out by, you said the average medium house was around that $400,000-$500,000 range. So multiply that out times five. That's how much you would be buying to get to a 6.5 interest rate.
That's $20,000.
$20,000.
That is.
Where does that $20,000 go?
And where does it come from? Because it comes out of your pocket.
It comes out of your pocket.
The buy down comes, the buy down comes out of the seller's pocket.
Right. Right. So, and again, yes, the on a permanent buy down, it can come from the seller as well. It doesn't necessarily have to, on a temporary buy down, it cannot come from your money.
Right.
From your pocket.
So with the buy down, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that gives the realtor enough leeway to better negotiate for those concessions from the seller.
Yeah.
Because they like, hey, my buyer needs a buy down. He can't pay it. It's 2.375 points. He can't pay it. But by law, he can't pay it.
Right.
So this is what we need these concessions for. And I think that's an easier way to negotiate some of those concessions. That way you can get 2% down, because you're not going to be able to buy your rate from 7.5 to 5.5. Like, you're just not. It's going
permanently.
Not permanently.
It's going to cost you too much money. And right, one of the points that we didn't touch on, why you also eloquently spoke about it, I feel proud. When you exercise a temporary buy down, the money that is spent, the money that you spend to do so is not spent.
Right.
It's put into your escrow.
Right.
Okay. It's put
that in little, is so exciting to me.
Yeah. Little, yeah. Yeah. It's put into your escrow. It's put over to the side. Okay. So I'm dumbing it down because some people may not know what escrow is. Right. Escrow is just a little savings that you have on the side. Escrow is typically used to pay your taxes and your insurance. Mm-hmm. The buy down money will also go into an escrow as well.
Right.
Why that is important is because when it comes time for you to refinance, the truth of the matter is it's in the wording. People will tell you refinancing doesn't cost you anything. Doesn't mean that it's free.
Right.
Right. When they say it doesn't cost you anything out of pocket, that doesn't mean that it's free. Typically, right. When you have a refinance, the cost of the refinance is rolled into your new loan. Mm-hmm. So you don't come out of your pocket with anything, but you're still paying for it down the line. If you happen to do a buy down and you have that money in the escrow, i.e. reserve, for my hood folks in the stash, why can't I ever be serious? I'm trying to be intellectual.
However you get the message out.
I'm fine.
You never know who you're reaching.
Right. You never know who you're reaching. Mattress money need houses too.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I told you my dream job, if I was to get into some illegal stuff, I would be a Marty Bird for my homeboys back then.
How about that?
Yeah, I want to teach them how to diversify their funds and like Marty clean their money. Like that's
Ozark reference.
If I wasn't doing this,
right.
I'm just saying. So right. Like we don't know who we're reaching.
I'm more wholesome than him. If you were like a wholesome loan officer, as opposed to someone that just said they would cheat, call me.
If you want to get into some shit.
Call him.
I refer you to the right loan officer.
Right.
No matter what your situation.
Right. If you want to clear the clothes the crooked way, if you want to clear the clothes the straight way, if you want to clear the clothes period, there you go. 1, 2, 3. But to not get off that point, so that money that you spent for the temporary buy down goes into your escrow, so when it's time for us to refinance you and get into a lower rate, you have that money to quote-unquote spend.
Right.
Okay, so that is the hottest topic right now, right? That mm-hmm. is beneficial into getting these people into homes. The chain of command, right? When we talk about getting people into homes, we would love for you to call us first. But that's not typically how it works out here. Typically right. how it works is you all call a realtor.
Mm-hmm.
And who better than our girl Bag Don't Lie? Bag Don't Lie is on set today. So if there's someone out here and our 11 million viewers
yes.
that are watching us,
yes.
you got someone that wants to sell a house.
Mm-hmm.
They know somebody that wants to sell a house. Mm-hmm. They know somebody that want to buy a house. They want to buy a house. Shoot your shot. Tell them why, who, what, when, and why.
Yeah.
Introduce yourself to the people that's been watching and listening.
I'm the best.
I am the sauce.
Right.
I am the sauce. No, but seriously, I'm going to get it done. Nobody's going to work harder. Nobody's going to communicate better. Nobody has a better list of resources, a better list of partners and vendors. Whatever your situation is, whatever your price point is, whatever your pain point is, we can address it. And I'm going to be there for you and be there with you throughout the entire process. And we're going to get it done.
How can the people, what is the most easiest way for the people to reach you?
Instagram -soldit. That's my handle on everything. So TikTok, Facebook, -soldit.com, my website. Yeah. And through any of those, you can get to the website and there'll be a link to schedule a free consultation.
Do you want
to
provide a number for them as well?
Yeah. My business number is 470-387-9015. I will say, I have gotten some creepy stuff sent to that phone. Since it's a public number, people, it's just, it's crazy out here.
I got you.
I'll bet. I'll bet.
Business only.
Business only.
Don't be out here being creepy.
Yeah.
I
had a man call one time. Hey, I sent you a DM. I don't know if you got it. So you thought you was gonna call me and I was gonna
I can ghost you on here also.
Right.
But yeah, so in the spirit of time, y'all, we can have this great conversation. It will go on and on, and we miss these calls that you guys are calling. Hold on, hello, I hear the phone ringing. Right, but no. As always, we want you to contact us with your real estate needs. Contact Jimmy with your loan questions. Contact me with your loan questions. Contact Dashondra with your purchase and sales questions, mm-hmm. and consultations. How they can set up a consultation on the website, I'm assuming?
Yes. So if you go to dashsoldier.com, the first button on there will be to schedule a consultation, and then you can follow the prompts. It's free for buyers and sellers. I do have a new agent consultation. So for any agents that are looking for guidance on how to get started in the business, or you don't even have your license yet and you want to get walked through that process, there I have a consultation there as well, but it is $100 for the hour. So
for the agents.
For agents.
You ain't picking her brain for free, agent.
Right. Talk to the experts. Listen to the experts.
Yeah. Yeah.
Listen to the experts.
Yeah. If you think I'm worthy to listen to, you can listen to me, but what do I know? We're back. Because we had said cut.
This for the Patreon.
You know what I mean?
This
for,
how about that? Bonus this for the Patreon,
right? Y'all got to pay $100 for this.
Right.
But Dashondra was like, I had some stuff I wanted to say. Y'all don't be talking. Y'all men. Y'all men ain't let me talk.
So you were speaking about when we were talking about the... where everybody thinks there's a potential for another crash.
Yes. So I want to speak to the idea of a crash and why this market is so much different than where we were in 2008. That was mortgage fraud happening then. So people were getting mortgages that did not qualify for them. People were, you know, getting mortgages with little to no documentation, little to no income verification. Since that crash, the mortgage industry, which I'm sure you guys can speak to, has completely revamped, and Georgia was number one for mortgage fraud. So it's, you know, it's a lot stricter process now. It's a lot more in-depth and detailed. So what we experienced then is completely different from the market we are in now. This is simply economics, supply and demand. So while things may stable out, while you may see less competition, you won't see the plummet. You won't see the bottom fall out like what happened in 2008.
Yes. Right. So like you said before, like the way that we have to go through getting people loans now, because back in the day, we pretty much said, like, all you need is a pen and a pulse to get a loan. Right.
We had people, you want a house? You can
right.
have a house.
Oh, you work at McDonald's? You drop the fries at McDonald's? And you wrote on here you make $100,000 a year. Okay.
You the best fries.
Right.
Your fries are salty and crispy.
Every
right.
time.
Right.
So now on the flip side, like, people always have their horror stories about going through underwriting and having to, like, give all this document and a drop of blood and one of their arms and the firstborn. Right. Yeah. That is why. Because we make 1,000% sure that you can pay that loan back now. So to your point, like, we've overregulated in some ways. I think we've overregulated to the point where there's no crash coming.
Yeah.
Like the bond market and the housing market, the loans that we're doing now are more than stable to where, like, okay, there's no risk of default in these because we've crossed every T, dotted every I to make sure that this person can afford this home.
Yeah.
And in addition to the as a part of the regulation, the people doing the loans now, loan officers, myself, Jimmy, we are licensed professionals.
Yes. We had to take a test.
We had it.
Several hours.
Yes.
Several hours of education.
Several hours.
Several documents to sign saying that we would not commit mortgage fraud on your behalf.
And continuous education. So, and this isn't to shade or shade or shame loan officers back at that time, but the reality was, the reality of it is, they were just people who was like, okay, I'll they were admin people,
right
and that, and it has nothing, I want to use that word loosely with all due respect to admin people. Jimmy and I are, we had to take an exam, we are licensed professionals, so loan officers across the board are licensed.
It's a higher standard
not across the board.
Well,
because if you work at a bank, you still don't have to be licensed.
Correct.
Like,
correct.
If you work as a mortgage loan originator for Bank of America, Chase, Wells Fargo, like any bank like that, then you can go under their license. Like, right. It's still regulated. They still have rules that they have to follow. But if you come to us, you already know that, like, we have rules that we have to follow ourselves, not right. just for the company.
Yeah. Right. So there's more backstops in play so that the crash that people are referencing, and it's become, that's become like grandma's ham now, like I do it this way because grandma did it that way,
right?
It ain't happening. It's not gonna. And again, there's too much, and even here in Atlanta, there's too much new money here that will support the market in terms of people will come in and be like, I'm buying all of this.
Yeah.
Like, you want to talk about some buy back the block shit?
Right.
Yeah. It will be bought. Like, it ain't, it, we've plateaued probably. We will settle out. We did this. We're doing this. We will probably do this for a long time. This is not going to happen.
Yeah.
So I think it's, we all are on one accord in that belief.
Right.
So if your belief is, I'm going to wait till everything, the bottom drops out, the bottom ain't dropping.
You're going to be waiting.
You're going to be waiting.
And renting a while.
You're going to be renting. And what's they say? I know rates are 7%, but rent is 100%. You know, I hate those.
I hate that too. And I think people don't even really understand what that means. Like, if you have not had exposure to, like, getting a mortgage, you like, what does that even mean? That rent is 100%. So interest is what you're paying in addition to what you're paying that goes toward the purchase of your property.
Right.
So when they say rent is 100%, it's because all of that, none of that is going toward the purchase of your property.
None of it is going towards the purchase of your property. So
I like to tell people, like, you paying somebody's mortgage regardless.
Yeah.
You might as well be paying your own.
Yeah.
You smell.
You look smart.
You look smart, bud.
I try to be. I try.
You know, your parents should be proud. But so that's it on the crash.
Yeah.
My feelings on the crash. This was excerpt.
Yeah.
This was added. This was added sauce.
Overtime.
Added sauce, baby. We'll get up with y'all next week. Stay black. Stay blessed.
Peace.
Even if you ain't black, stay black. I'm out.